On March 16th, 1965, Viola Liuzzo, a woman who possessed strong convictions and a demonstrating willingness to take action in causes she believed in, left Detroit, Michigan to take part in voting rights protests in Selma, Alabama. When she got to Selma, Liuzzo took part in numerous activities related to the historic Selma to Montgomery Voting Rights March, including working at the hospitality desk at Brown's Chapel and providing first aid to the marchers. On the morning of March 25th, prior to the final demonstration at the state capitol, Viola had a premonition that someone would be killed that day, maybe even Governor George Wallace. After time and prayer, she felt better and participated in a final rally at the Capitol building in Montgomery, where Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. spoke.
Because truth crushed the earth will rise again.
Yes, sir.
How long? Not long.
Yes, sir.
Because no lie can live forever.
Yes, sir.
That evening, Liuzzo returned to Selma with a group of marchers and Leroy Moten, a young civil rights worker who'd been using her car to transport marchers from Montgomery to Selma. Liuzzo and Moten headed back to Montgomery to pick up any remaining marchers before she headed back home to Detroit. At the beginning of their return trip to Montgomery, a group of four Klansmen stopped near Liuzzo's car near the Edmund Pettus Bridge. When they spotted a white woman driving a young black male passenger, they decided to follow and attack Liuzzo and Moten. On Highway 80, between Selma and Montgomery, the Klansmen pulled next to Liuzzo's car and shot at her. Viola was struck in the head and died instantly, causing her car to leave the road and come to rest near a fence. Moten was not hit by any of the gunshots, but he was covered in Viola's blood and pretended to be dead when the Klansmen came back to check their results. After the Klansmen drove away, Moten flagged down a truck carrying marchers and returned to Selma, where he reported Liuzzo's murder. Without any witnesses to identify suspects, this case would have been very difficult to solve. One of the Klansmen was actually a paid FBI informant who contacted his superiors shortly after the shooting to report what happened. The morning after Liuzzo was murdered, all four Klansmen were arrested. Collie Leroy Wilkins, William Orville Eaton, and Eugene Thomas faced both state murder charges and federal charges of depriving Liuzzo of her civil rights. Gary Thomas Rowe was the FBI informant and was given immunity in exchange for his testimony. An all-white jury acquitted Wilkins, Eaton, and Thomas of the state murder charges, but the federal jury convicted the three of depriving Liuzzo of her civil rights, sentencing each of them to 10 years in prison, which was the maximum penalty. William Orville Eaton died before he began his sentence. Following Viola Liuzzo's death, President Lyndon Johnson ordered an investigation of the KKK and petitioned Congress to make it legal to file federal murder charges against killers of civil rights workers.
I'm asking and directing Attorney General Katzenbach to proceed at the earliest possible date to develop legislation that will bring the activities of the Klan under effective control of the law.
In the aftermath of her death, Viola Liuzzo was smeared by the FBI and the media. She was portrayed as an unstable woman with questionable motives, and her husband was portrayed as a thug. Gender stereotypes of that time caused many to believe that Viola should have stayed at home and tended to her family instead of getting involved with the voting rights protests. Despite the attempts to destroy her character, Liuzzo has received deserved recognition, being added to the Civil Rights Memorial in Montgomery in 1989, and in 1991, the women of the Southern Christian Leadership Conference erected a stone marker on Highway 80 at the spot where she was murdered. Viola's legacy is that of a passionate, caring woman who lost her life fighting for equality.